Hey students, good evening and welcome to Dr. Kalam IAS Academy. Let us continue our discussion with respect to the concepts in ethics. As of now, we have completed some of the most important concepts in ethics. These are this. I think by now, at least you have got conceptual clarity about these things. These are the seven things which reverberate around throughout your syllabus in all questions. Last one, emotional intelligence. This is a separate thing. It is not having any overlapping with the whole syllabus. Emotional intelligence is emotions. Using these emotions for your benefit. What is emotional intelligence? Using our emotions for our benefits, not for other way around, not for destruction. Using our emotions to increase production, to increase productivity, to increase efficiency means making best use of emotions. Emotional intelligence is a concept which says that emotions are intelligent. How can you say that emotions are intelligent? Say, for example, you want to catch a train at 6 a.m. You woke up. You set your alarm to wake up at 5. But when you saw that, when you woke up, it was 5:30. You become little tense. Your body warms up. You won't feel drowsy. You feel like rushing. Don't you feel emotions are intelligent? Say, for example, you are standing here. Suddenly, when you turned back, you saw a lion. You are already tired, you are standing. What will be the emotions? What is their utility? After seeing the lion, will you feel like sleeping? Say, for example, there is a teacher, very strict teacher, you got some emotions. Why? There is a very liberal teacher, you got some emotions. Why? These are to save you. So, since emotional intelligence is not having overlapping on the other subject, we'll discuss in depth as a separate thing. Before that, just understand that emotional intelligence means understanding the emotions. Understanding the emotions in you and in others. Right? For all other things. This is the basic. Everything proceeds from these things. What is emotional intelligence? Emotional intelligence is understanding your emotions and understanding others' emotions and using emotions for your benefit, not for your adverse. This is the thing. I think till here, everything is pretty clear for you. Then one important thing which you have to focus is ethics. Ethics focuses on human actions. Actus humanus. Human actions, human humanus. Actus humanus. Because they are deliberate human actions. Not on actus hominis, undeliberate. Given by St. Thomas Aquinas. This is very, very important. For any action to be once again called as human action, it should be done with knowledge, voluntary, and freedom. You know these things. These are very, very important and fundamental. Then we discuss that though religion, your feelings, the laws, the society, all have basis in ethics, they cannot be equated for it. And also, you cannot say that you don't know ethics. Each society has a culture. each culture has ethics. So being a part of culture, being a part of society, you know what is ethics is. You may not be able to tell that, explain that correctly. That is the thing. Very, very important. Please concentrate these lines, because these are given by second ARC. As it is, a question may come. And also, in syllabus, you have what? Laws, rules, regulation, and conscience as a source of ethical guidance. See, in our previous slide, we just said that ethics cannot be equated to religion, feelings, societal standards, law. But once again, here in the syllabus, they have given laws, rules, regulation, conscience as a source of ethical guidance. Yes, students, here the gist is, what is ethical in a society? What is ethics in a society? Depends upon the vision what people have. What is ethics in a society depends on what people think is right and wrong. Rules, laws, these are the things which are the basis which act as an ethical guidance. And also, ethics provide basis for this creation of these laws and rules. It is the moral ideals of the people that give rise to and shape the character of the laws and rules. It is the moral ideals, what people think has good and bad, that gives rise to and that shapes your laws and rules are raised from, are shaped based on the moral ideals, what people think as the ideal thing. Not only that, our legal system emanates from the shared vision of what is good, what is just. So in this way, ethics is related to law also. This we have discussed. After that, we discussed that ethics is equal to standards. Following these standards is your integrity. Right? Afterwards, we discussed that value is a very bigger thing. Anything important for an individual organization, all these things, is value. Inside value, there are some values. There are some values which are in the form of standards or principles which say what is right and what is wrong, just in just. This is your ethics or morals. When all these things are practiced, are followed consistently, that leads to your integrity. Same things in official capacity, in professional life, are known as probity. When these values, when you attach, when you give values to some subject, some object, say for example, some individual. For this individual, you are attaching some values. Then it becomes attitude. By attaching your values, what you are doing? You are evaluating. So evaluative judgments towards an object is known as attitude. This evaluative judgments comes from you attaching the values to a subject. These are the things in gist we have already discussed. I hope you don't have any doubt in this regard. Ethics refers to standard. Then what is the supreme ethical standard in this regard? We discuss the important, most important things which are reverberated throughout the syllabus. One is, an individual may do some work. In this, he may use some means to achieve some end. This individual may have certain character. those who say that ethics, for anything related to ethics, you have to consider only the ends, result, outcomes are known as consequentialists. Those who say that ethics is located or contingent on the means are known as deontology. Those who say that ethics is related to the character, related to the virtues present in an individual. Virtue means excellence of a character, which leads one to act morally praiseworthy manner. These are known as virtuous ethics. I think till here you have got a fair idea. So this is a very, very old, ancient philosophy. Here, something present in the individual, that character, is given importance. Now, recent and the latest modern times, they give importance to freedom. Almost this virtuous theory was given by Aristotle, Plato some 2000 years back. Here, when you give importance and when you say that a person having virtues, he will be doing ethical things, that is your virtuous ethics. When you say that, you have to give full freedom or liberty to an individual, because we own ourselves, that results to libertarianism. And one which says that we have to take into account the contract, what we have with another individual, is contractarian. So these are the main five standards, supreme ethical standards. Right? Let me just brief once again. Dear students, classically, we can say that consequences, ends, means, rights, are the virtues, excellent character present in an organization, individual, are taken as a basis, are said to locate ethics in them. Along with that, recent studies, recent philosophers have also added two other dimensions. One is libertarianism. The difference between virtuous and libertarianism is, here you are concentrating on virtues, on character. In libertarian, we are concentrating on liberty. We are concentrating on freedom. As we move and as we come across a political organization where we have a kind of contract, social contract theory, contract is also an important thing to be considered to know whether it is ethical or not. These are the five things. So this is a very brief of the things to understand what is ethics. Please interconnect the things. Now I have said you, what is ethics? Ethics means set of standards. What is the basis of ethics of this thing? As we proceed, we'll still elaborate in detail with respect to all these things. Right? Having said that, all the eight things, values, ethics, morals, attitude, aptitude, integrity, probity, emotional intelligence, these are the concepts which are present. These are applied to these nine items. Then we can consider in broad way three broad categories. As I told you, these concepts are applied to these three broad categories. See, let's see in the syllabus itself. See, these are the things which you can understand. The first chapter, second chapter, okay, there is nothing there much. Bureaucracy, administration, and public administration. See here, aptitude and foundational values of civil service. You should know what is civil service. Emotional intelligence in administration. So you should know what is administration. Civil service values or public service values. So you should know what is civil service and also what is public service. Ethics in public administration, you should know what is public administration. Probity in governance, 7th chapter, the name of the chapter itself is governance. So you should know what is governance. Yes, students. So it is very, very pertinent that you know the meaning of all this. Right? In this direction, understanding these concepts become very, very important. The things which I have used in same color have interrelated. To understand civil service, public service, you should know first what is administration, what is public administration, what is bureaucracy. Afterwards, you have to put these things and you have to correlate with what is government, what is governance, what is good governance, what is ethical governance. Afterwards, we can come back to civil service or public service. In this direction, going further, today we'll understand these three concepts. Dear students, these three concepts are very, very important. Not only that, the things what I have shown you are directly present in your paper one prelims also. Indian polity and governance, constitution, political system, panchayat raj, public policy, rights issue. In paper three, that is your GS2, directly you can have governance, constitution related things, and in the back end you have got a chapter which consists of entirely of these things, which are also the subject matter of the things which we study in our ethics. Role of civil service in democracy. So to know what is civil service, you should know what is administration, you should know what is public administration, you should know what is government, what is governance, then only you can answer these questions. So in this direction, we'll be discussing these things. Let us just have a glance through previous year questions. 2014, what does ethics seek to promote in human life? What does ethics seek to promote in human life? Why is it all more important in public administration? See, you should know what is public administration. Next, there is heavy ethical responsibility on public servants because they occupy positions of power, handle huge amounts of public funds, and their decisions have wide-ranging impact on society and environment. What steps have you taken to improve the ethical competence to handle such responsibility? See here. Very, very important. I often tell you and have been telling, previous year questions are very, very important. Dear students, by previous year questions, you can like see what is there in the mind of a UPSC question paper setter. What is the status of the UPSC question paper setter? See, this is a question in that UPSC itself is saying that there is a heavy ethical responsibility. Maybe ethical responsibility on the public administrators. See, this is very, very important. Why they have heavy ethical responsibility? Because they occupy positions of power, handle huge amounts of funds. Their decisions have a wide-ranging impact on society and environment. Is this clear? Any question, yes, students, any question, please take very, very important concepts given. Very, very important concepts. See here, this is a concept which you have to take. This is what is there in UPSC question paper setter's mind. Ethical responsibility with respect to public servants is these things according to UPSC. Like that, dear students, if you go through all the previous year questions, you can get more than 50 concepts. You can get 50 concepts according to UPSC. What UPSC means? Say, for example, emotional intelligence. Previously, we had a question. Emotional intelligence refers to using emotions for our advantage or benefit. See, that is a concept which is present in UPSC mind. These things are very, very subjective. So here also you know the meaning of public servant, civil servant. 2015, two different kinds of attitudes exhibited by public servants towards their work have been identified as bureaucratic attitude and democratic attitude. There are two kinds of attitude exhibited by public servants. One is bureaucratic attitude. You should know what is bureaucracy. Without you knowing those, how can you answer bureaucratic attitude? So you should know what is bureaucracy, which we'll be discussing today. Next, in 2016, we had another question in the same lines. Please concentrate. It's a very, very important question. Max Weber said that it is not wise to apply to the public administration the sort of moral and ethical norms we apply to the matters of personal conscience. I read it again. According to Max Weber, it is not wise to apply to public administration the sort of moral and ethical norms we apply to the matters of personal conscience. What he is saying is, in bureaucracy, we have what a different thing. What we have in personal conscience or personal relations, private life, those things we cannot apply to bureaucracy. It is important to realize that state bureaucracy might possess its own independent bureaucratic morality. See here, this is a society. Think that in this society, group of people who are working, these are the people who are working in for government, or these are the people who are working in bureaucracy. Think that these are the people who are working for bureaucracy. The people don't have many political rights. Like, they cannot say which party, they cannot take any sides. And also there are many restrictions. See, for example, when you enter bureaucracy, you are bound by certain things. So here, say for example, here bureaucrats are not allowed to express their public opinion towards a political party. Don't you feel that these rights are taken away? Right to freedom of bureaucrats are taken away? Weber says that, see, that may be the case, but bureaucracy should have its own morality, independent bureaucratic moral, which is different from the other members of the society. A police officer working in the bureaucracy, a collector working in the bureaucracy, should have a different standard, different ethical standard, moral standard. The same not said that it is not wise to apply to public administration sort of moral and ethical norms we apply to the matters of personal conscience. Freedom, liberty, equality, fraternity, all what we have to personal conscience in general, we cannot have all these things in bureaucracy. It is very important to realize that state bureaucracy might possess its own independent bureaucratic morality. So what is moral, what is ethical in a bureaucracy should be independent of the society, he is saying. We'll discuss why all these things. So this is see here, in 2019, they have given a case study itself, case study, which was in the form of a passage, a question come answer. Please go through that. Let's not waste the time. In the same year, we also had a case study about politicization of bureaucracy. So these are some of the questions which you have to keep in mind before you delve into those things, right? So what is administration? What is administration? Think it over. This is a conceptual thing. You have to frame a correct concept of what is administration. Whenever somebody say administrative head, administrative building, administrative officer, administration itself, private administration, public administration, college administration, municipal administration. What do you feel? Literally, the term administration means management of affairs. Administration literally means management of affairs. This may be in private or public. Literally means management of affairs. Administration is the organization and use of men and materials to accomplish a purpose. See, I'll be taking up some 3 to 4 definitions, very important, like the cream with respect to this topic. But in all these things, this is the one which reverberates. What do you mean by administration? Administration means organizing. Administration is organization. And use of men and material, human resources, and also other physical assets also. Why you are using? To accomplish a purpose. So here, what is that? Administration, number one, it is a group activity. It is a group activity. In administration, you are using men and material. And thirdly, you are using to accomplish an end, purpose, goal, or an objective. This is a general thing. You can add cooperative group activity. What is administration? Administration is a cooperative group activity where they use men and material to accomplish the purpose. This is the meaning of administration. So in syllabus, you have what one area, emotional intelligence and its utilities, concepts and application to administration. So in everywhere, in public and private, you can use that. According to Simon, a person who got Nobel Prize, according to him, administration is defined as the activities of groups. Administration is not individual. This refers to the activities of groups cooperating to accomplish common goals. This is yet another simple holistic definition. Anywhere in anywhere you go, administration includes activities of groups, not individual. These groups are not antagonistic, they are cooperating. And they are cooperating to achieve the common goals. So if you find the previous definition which we took a little bit complicated, you can take these three things. So activities of groups cooperating to accomplish common purpose, the same meaning. According to Pittner, another public administrationist, administration is organization and direction of human material resources to achieve the desired. Here also he feels that administration is the organization. What is the meaning of organization? We'll understand in 2 seconds. Organization and also direction. Yes, added the another word, direction. Yet L.K. White, according to him, the art of administration, he makes the administration an art, not a science. The art of administration is the direction, coordination, and control of many persons to achieve some purpose or objective. See here, in all these things, almost they mean the same. They're missing little things there and adding some other things. See here, compared to our previous definition, cooperating was added by Simon. We find something extra. Pittner added the thing, direction. See, L.D. White once again said, direction, cooperation, control also he had added of many purpose to achieve the purpose. Right? Is the concept clear to you? once again, administration, which is, what are the things which has to be present? It is the activity of groups. It is the activity of many people. So it is a group activity. And cooperative group activity. With respect here, there is direction, coordination, control. To achieve some goals is the third one. So if these three things are present, then we say that is administration, right? Same things, just I'll be reading the thing. Administration is determined action taken in pursuit of conscious purpose. Administration is the systematic ordering of the affairs and the calculated use of resources aimed at making those happen which one wants to happen. Please concentrate here. Administration has two essential elements. All these things about administration you can find in Lakshmikant Public Administration book. Along with that, Mohit Bhattacharya, well-known writer. So these are the two things which I have referred for these things. No need for you to refer. I have given everything you needed and I have removed many things which are confusing. Administration has two essential elements, that is collective effort and common purpose. Collective effort and common purpose. Along with that, collective effort, you can add the things like direction, control, coordination, right? The most essential, collective effort and common purpose. Thus, administration means coordinated effort of a group of people in pursuit of common objective. Yes, students, I have given many definitions. In that, you come up with one definition. Means you make one definition and you stick to it. More than sufficient. Don't get confused with all these definitions. Just to have different views, dimensions, have taken all these things. So here, administration is a universal process and occurs in diverse institutional settings. Administration, as I told you, it may be present in private, public, non-governmental. So it is a universal process and occurs in diverse institutional settings. Based on the institutional setting, administration is divided into public administration and private administration. Administration is a universal process and it occurs in different institutional settings. When it is happening in public administration, when it is happening in government settings, then we say that public administration. When it is operating in non-governmental setting, it is known as private administration. Public administration refers to administration which operates in government setting, while private administration refers to administration which operates in non-governmental setting, that is the business enterprises. This is clear. Administration which is operating in government setting is public administration. Administration which is happening in non-government organizations is known as private administration. Is it clear? The public in public administration refers to government. Public in public administration is equal to government. So public administration simply refers to administration in government setting. Right, I think now there may arise some few doubt as to what is administration, what is organization, what is management. Think it over. What is administration? What is organization? What is management? Try to connect these things. Try to connect these things. These things are used interchangeably. However, there are specific differences in this meaning. Administration, organization, and management. In general parlance, somehow, please listen the words carefully. In general parlance, these things are used interchangeably. However, there is specific difference in their meaning. Is it clear? There is specific difference in the meaning of these things, but generally these things are used interchangeably. What are the similarities? What are the differences? Administration is the force which lays down the object for which an organization and its management are to strive, and the broad policies under which they are. So, administration is the force which lays down the object for which an organization and management are to strive. Administration is a force which lays down the objective, for organization and also for management, and also broad principles, broad policies under which they are to operate. Means how organization has to operate, how management has to operate is decided by your administration. Dear students, please concentrate here. Administration does two important things. One is it lays down the object as to what your organization and what your management has to do. So organization object, management goal, management end, it is determined by your administration. Not only that, the principles which are to be followed by these two, the policies, please give your attention here. For organization and management, the goal is determined by your administration. The goal is determined. Goal of organization and management is determined by administration. At the same time, how will you achieve these goals? What are the criteria you have to take into consideration? What is the policy? That is also given by administration. So administration decides the objective, the goal of organization and management, and also the principles which has to be followed by organization and management. An organization is a combination of necessary human beings, materials, tools, equipment, and working space. So, organization refers to a combination of human and also material things. What is organization? Organization is a combination of necessary human and also materials. This being the form of tools, equipment, working force, apparatus, which are brought together in systematic and effective correlation to accomplish some desired object. So, what is organization? Organization is the combination of men and material. Organization is the combination of men and material. Why you have this combination? What is this combination? This is determined by the goal through which organization will strive. Management is that which leads, guides, and directs an organization for the accomplishment of a predetermined object. So who is determining this predetermined object? This is by administration. Let me just put these things in a diagrammatical form. Administration this is like bill. This is your organization. Manage. How organization has to work? How organization has to work? What are the goals of the organization? Is determined by administration. How management has to work? What are the principles it has to use? Is determined by administration. Once again, this organization has certain goals. These goals are taken care by the management, because management leads, guides, and directs the organization for the accomplishment of the object, the goals determined by the administration. I'll make the things clear for you again. See here. Administration is the function of the industry in the determination of the policy. Just understand one word and correlate the thing. Administration is policy. Administration is policy. Management is the function in the industry concerned with the execution of the policy. Administration is policy. Management is execution of policy. Management is execution of the policy. Within the limits set by the administration and employment of organization for a particular object set within it. Administration determines the policies, gives the goals, gives the policy framework. Management execute that one. While executing that, it uses the organization. Administration policy, management execution of the policy. To execute this policy, management uses the organization, which consists of men and materials. Moving further, organization is the formation of an effective machine, management of effective executive, administration and effective direction. Very, very powerful. Organization. What is organization? Is an effective machine. Management is an effective executive. Administration is direction. Please understand here. Organization is machine. This machine is used by management to execute the policies, directions set by the administration. Administration determines the organization. Management uses it. Administration defines the goal. Management strives towards it. Organization is the machine of the management in its achievement of the ends determined by the administration. This is a crux. In a very, very beautiful, simplified way I have answered. Yes, students. Here, everything I have in a crisp way, I have made the things. So whenever there is a general question, you can use administration, organization, management interchangeably. General question. But there are specific, if this is in accordance with the public administration, this is in accordance with the management. So by this, what we can understand? We can understand that administration is a broader concept and includes within itself both organization and management. This is about administration. So very simple thing. Yes, students, the concept which I'll be discussing today are a bit difficult. So I request you all to go home and revise the things. Until and unless you revise, it will appear like as though very difficult for you. Right? So bureaucracy. This is one of the most important things, that people lack conceptual clarity with respect to bureaucracy. As I have shown you, without knowing the meaning of bureaucracy, you cannot answer any questions from bureaucracy. Already 3 to 4 UPSC questions have appeared where they are asking directly the things related to bureaucracy. One important thing, bureaucracy, don't confuse it with civil service. Civil service is different, bureaucracy is different. As we proceed, you can understand those things. What is bureaucracy? In fact, bureaucracy is a concept. Bureaucracy is a concept. Dear students, please think of any big organization. Please take a while. Please think of any big organization which you know. Any big organization. Amazon, Google, Facebook, big organizations, police, military, administration, big organizations. See, when I wrote these things, Amazon, Google, Facebook, all these things were not present some 20, 30 years before, isn't it? But your police organization, military organization, similar administration, they are there from the time immemorial, from the beginning of the civilization. Right? Big organization. Let us take police organization. Before that, I would like to tell you one very, very important thing. Bureaucracy is a concept. Bureaucracy is an idea. Bureaucracy is a set of ideas to run any big organization. So I'll be discussing some of the characteristics of bureaucracy. As we proceed, you will understand that all big organizations have these characteristics. All big organizations invariably for effective management should have certain characteristics. These characteristics are termed as bureaucratic characteristics. Please understand that very important thing. All big organizations for effective management, organization and administration of all big organizations, there is a need that all these big organizations and institutions should follow certain criteria. This set of criteria are known as bureaucracy. Invariably, all big organizations will have this kind. Let us take examples. Police organization, you have like simple, the things which you know will take. Constable. After that, we'll have head constable. After that, you have got sub-inspector. Afterwards, you have a DYSP, Deputy Superintendent of Police. After that, you have a SP. We stop here. This is enough for you to understand. What you see here, you find in hierarchy. What do you mean by hierarchy? Hierarchy means the ultimate control. Ultimate control and supervision of the subordinate rests with the higher official. Then only we can say that there is hierarchy. Take the example of military. Take the example of your Amazon, Flipkart, Google. In all these things, these characteristics are present. if Amazon, Google, your police organization, your military organization, if they don't use this principle, then you cannot think of managing a big organization at all. All big organizations follow the principles or characteristics which can be collectively known as bureaucratic care. Let me clear the things and go in a sequential. Dear students, as you are aware, Max Weber, very important, because he is a person who has given the concrete things with respect to bureaucracy. Max Weber holds a unique position in the galaxy of administrative political thinkers who made an attempt to explain the concept of bureaucracy. Bureaucracy is a concept. In this, there are many galaxy, innumerable administrative political thinkers, but Weber stands apart. Why? In fact, the first scientific treatment of bureaucracy came from the writings of Weber. Who made the first scientific writing with respect to bureaucracy? Bureaucracy is a concept for managing any big organization. First scientific treatment of it was given by Max Weber. Thus, his name becomes synonymous with bureaucracy. As rightly observed by S.R. Maheshwari, a public administrationist, the credit for systematic formulation of bureaucratic theory goes to Max Weber. For he founded the modern sociological study of bureaucracy, freed the term from pejorative connotations, emphasized the indispensability of bureaucracy for the rational attainments of the goals of an organization. See how young the bureaucracy concept is. It's just around 1,000, 2,000 years. That's it. Number one, question may be like anywhere. Why? Bureaucracy has become similar to Max Weber. We have to write all this. Because he is the first person who gave a scientific treatment. Not only that, he removed all the prerogative connotation. And most importantly, he emphasized the indispensability of bureaucracy for the rational attainment of the goals of an organization. Rational is one which is based on reason, which is based on knowledge. If you want to attain the goals in a rational way, you have to use the bureaucracy. Weber gave some formulation characters which he called ideal time. The ideal type is just a mental map. It's a mental construct. In its conceptual purity, this mental construct cannot be found empirically anywhere in reality. It is a utopia. This is clear. This is with respect to the concept of bureaucracy. Bureaucracy, according to Weber, is an ideal type. For what? For rational attainments of the goals of the organization. It's an ideal type. It's a mental makeup. It is not present in physical form. It cannot be found empirically anywhere in reality. In reality, pure bureaucratic thing cannot be found. It lost by our Mohit Bhattacharya. He says that in the Weberian formulation, bureaucracy is not to be confused with civil service. It refers to the sociological concept of rationalization of collective activity. What is bureaucracy? Bureaucracy refers to the rationalization of collective activities. Human, whenever he is involved in big organizations, or whenever he is involved in collective activity. It should be based on rationality. So rationalizing the collective activity is bureaucracy. So very, very concrete definition, you can take this. Bureaucracy is a concept of rationalization of collective activities. Bureaucracy is the concept of rationalization of the collective activity. So what are the take homes from this slide? Most important, students, Weber is synonymous with bureaucracy. Why? He was the first person who treated bureaucracy in a scientific way. And also, yes, the one who founded the modern sociological study of bureaucracy, freed the term from pejorative connotations, like very wrongful connotations, and emphasized the indispensability of bureaucracy. Bureaucracy is indispensable for the rational attainments of the goals of an organization. Bureaucracy is only an ideal tag. It doesn't exist. Ideal tag is the mental makeup, mental construct. It is conceptual purity. In this conceptual purity, this mental construct cannot be found empirically anywhere. According to Mohit Bhattacharya, according to Weber, bureaucracy refers to the concept of rationalization of collective activities. Should not be confused with civil service. This is just an introduction with respect to bureaucracy. So what is the take home? Bureaucracy is a concept. Bureaucracy is a concept for rationalizing the collective activity, rationalization for collective activity. In a layman way, we can say that bureaucracy is a concept to administer, manage, organize any big organization. Big organization have to follow certain principles. This set of principles are known as bureaucracy. To understand this better, you should have a fair understanding of authority, power, and also legality. According to Weber, the things are very, very simple. Here, power plus legality is equal to authority. Please concentrate here. Power plus legality is equal to authority. What is the type of authority one has depend on what is the legitimacy he has. Let me take one. Say, for example, there is a traditional system. There's a traditional system or anything to take care with respect to family, with respect to society. There, younger ones are obeying the elder ones. Younger ones are obeying the elder ones. Or we can say for example, people are obeying the priest. People are obeying the priest. Take the another circumstance where say for example, Chiranjeevi, Pawan Kalyan, Mahesh Babu, Rajinikanth. There are many diehard fans of these people. They are ready to do whatever they say. If Chiranjeevi drinks thumbs up, they say yes, thumbs up. Pawan Kalyan, the same. These people have a charismatic energy. These people have a charisma. So power plus legality is equal to authority. The type of authority what we have depends upon the type of legality. If your authority is based on the tradition, this is known as traditional authority. If the authority is based on some charismatic characters, the leader what we has, Gandhiji has a charismatic character, then charismatic authority. Then there is one more thing known as legal rational authority. That is bureaucracy. Bureaucracy is based on legal rational authority. Power means if the subject is willing to give you or not, with force you are getting the things done. But when there is authority, when there is authority, there is power and also legitimacy. Without you forcing anyone, they are submitting to your authority. Power plus legality is equal to authority. A 7th standard student or a rowdy in your area beating someone, maybe because of power. A parent beating his children because of authority. A parent beating a child, which kind of authority? It is a traditional authority. A student or someone following his leader is a charismatic authority. What is the legality present? Here, charisma. In bureaucracy, we have got legal rational authority. So this is the whole thing. It's a very, very different concept, difficult concept. Please understand, dear students. I'll sum up the things for you. Power plus legitimacy is equal to authority. The type of authority present depends upon the basis of legality. What is the legal thing present in an authority determined many things. In this regard, you have got traditional authority, parents, or any other thing, charismatic authority. Legal rational authority is your bureaucratic authority. Right? The probability that one actor within a social relationship will be in a position to carry out his own will despite resistance is known as power. What is power? Don't try to memorize this, dear students. Don't try to memorize. This is a very, very concrete, condensed one. Just take off some of the important words, and according to Weber, power is, you write, that is it. If you try to remember, you are making a big blunder, because you cannot remember for long. Power means the probability that one actor within a social relationship will be in a position to carry out his own will despite resistance. Power means when one actor, one individual in a social relationship, in a society, will be in a position to carry on his will. When one actor is in a position to carry on his will, despite resistance, that is power. While authority is the probability that the command with a given specific content will be obeyed by the given group of persons. On the other hand, authority means there is a high degree, there is a probability that the command with a specific content will be obeyed by the given persons. There is a kind of obeying. Thus, compared to power, authority is characterized by legitimacy, very, very important. That is voluntary obedience of the commands by the subordinates. So What is authority? Authority here refers to voluntary obedience. Authority here refers to voluntary obedience. So for authority, you can take a very key element, obedience. This is clear. So when we say that there is authority, then there is voluntary obedience. Voluntary obedience. In other words, legitimacy turns power into authority. In other words, legitimacy turns power into authority. Right? Power plus legitimacy is equal to authority. According to Weber, authority is synonymous to authoritative power of command. And he called it domination. He stated that all administration means domination. Administration means exercise of authority. So you don't take into consideration of these things. These are very, very deep concepts which have been taken care in public administration as an option. Simply means that in administration, there is a domination. Domination by certain rules, regulation, and concepts. So as of now, don't worry about this. But better you should have a feeling that I have heard this thing. If at all, if they ask, that is the reason why I have put it. Weber classified authority on the basis of its claim to legality. Weber classified authority. What was the basis for classification of authority? On the basis of claims of legality. So power plus legality is equal to authority. What is the basis for legality? On the basis of this legality, Weber classified authority. Am I making sense? Is this clear? Weber classified authority based on the basis of legality. Since on this would depend largely the type of obedience, the kind of administrative staff suitable to it, the ways of exercising the authority. These three pure types of legitimate authority are based respectively on these three basis of legitimacy. They are traditional authority, charismatic authority, legal rational authority. So please connect the things. We came from power. Afterwards, we moved on to authority. Afterwards, now we are classifying authority. We are classifying authority. What is the basis? We are classifying authority based on the legitimacy. What is the basis? On what legitimacy we have got authority? Why we are classifying authority? Why authority is classified based on the legitimacy, the type of legitimacy you have? Because the type of legitimacy determines the kind of obedience, the kind of administrative staff, the ways of exercising authority. Say, for example, traditional authority, parent and child. Charismatic authority, leader and his follower. Legal rational authority in a bureaucracy, in a police setup. Things are entirely different. Weber classified authority on the basis of its claim to legitimacy, since on this would depend largely the type of obedience, the kind of administrative staff suitable for it, the ways of exercising authority. These three pure types of legitimate authority are based respectively on these three bases of legitimacy. begin with, I'll just brief the things. Since you should have a fair understanding of the things, I have taken this thing. According to Weber, authority rests on, an established belief in the sanction of immortal tradition and legality of the status of those exercising under it. So in traditional authority, this authority rests on the established belief, in the sanctity of the immortal traditions and legitimacy of the status of those exercising authority under them. The extent of authority under this system is determined by the customs and precedents. In other words, obedience under this system is owed to the ruler who occupies the traditionally sanctioned position of the authority and who is bound by the tradition. The obligation of the obedience is a matter of personal loyalty within the area of accustomed obligation. Administrative staff under traditional system is either the patriarchal, feudal. In case of formal system, administrative operators will be personal, retired servants, relatives of the ruler. They owe traditional loyalty to him. While in case of later, administrative operators will be feudal lords. So as I said, Weber has classified authority based on the source of legality. In traditional administration, your authority is determined by the customs and precedents. The administrative staffs in traditional authority will be based on what is sanctioned. In traditional authority, administrative staff will be of patriarchal or feudal. Patriarchal means giving administration in the hands of those who are obedient. In this case, feudal laws. This is a general thing, but charismatic, you have to give little attention. The term charisma literally means the gift of grace. According to Weber, this authority rests on devotion to specific and exceptional sanctity, heroism or exemplary character of an individual and of a normative pattern or order relieved or ordained by him. Thus, ruler under this system possesses supernatural or superhuman qualities and he is obeyed by virtue of personal trust in him and his revelation. Charismatic person is a one who is having supernatural and superhuman characteristics. Because of this, we obey. On the other hand, there is a third one, that is legal rational authority. Please concentrate here. This is the crux. This is the reason I told all these things to make you understand these things. According to Weber, this authority rests on the belief in the legality of the patterns of normative rules and the rights of those elevated to authority under such rules to issue command. Thus, obedience under this system is owed to the legally sanctioned impersonal order. So in bureaucracy, obedience is for impersonal order, which is rational in character. It extends to persons exercising authority of office under it only by virtue of formal legality of their command and only within the scope of authority. Legal rational authority. You obey authority. See, in traditional authority, you obeyed because of the customs, traditions. In charismatic authority, you obeyed because of the supernatural characters or superhuman character that a person was having. You are obeying in a legal, rational authority. why in legal rational authority you are obeying to the impersonal order which is rational, impersonal, which is not concerned with that person. In legal rational authority, see, please understand the concept here. In traditional authority, you are obeying to customs traditions. You are not putting any question. Elders should be obeyed, you are obeying. There are many things you come across, for example, with respect to God, spirits or anything. But because of tradition, you just obeying. In charismatic things, you are obeying because of the supernatural things present in a human. In legal rational authority, not all these things. You are obeying because the order which is there, it is impersonal and it is also rational. It is legal. Thus, obedience under this system is owed to the legally established immoral order. So here obedience is to an order, to a rule, to a law. This order is rational. So in legal rational authority, you are obeying to an order. This order is not personal. And this order is rational. It extends to persons exercising authority of office and writ only by virtue of formal legality of the commands and only within the scope of authority of the office, not outside the authority of the office. Let me elaborate these things to make you understand better. So, what is bureaucracy? Bureaucracy is legal rational authority. This is the first thing which you have to understand. How to have an overall understanding about the bureaucracy? What is the need of bureaucracy? The sequence comes with this. We have to distinguish and we have to understand two important terms: power. Power means will. You want whatever you will, getting things done, even if there is resistance. Power is the ability of you getting done, even if there is resistance. On the other hand, authority is equal to obedience. Authority is equal to obedience means you are voluntarily doing something. Right? So, authority is equal to power plus legitimacy, legality. Authority is equal to power plus legitimacy. Legitimacy is a very important component of an authority. So, what kind of legitimacy you have got to make the power into authority determines the type of authority. Say, for example, charismatic authority. In this case, who will be the administrative staff? The administrative staff will be the followers of this charismatic person. Like that, when you take legality as the factor or the basis, authority can be divided into three types. One is traditional authority, another is charismatic authority, and the authority which is based on legal rationality. The authority which is legal and also rational. Obedience is not to the person who holds the authority, but to the impersonal order which is rational. Let me explain this. Here, there is a SI. We take two circumstances also. There is a SI in police department. Here, two kinds of obedience. A constable is also obeying. This is within the organization. And in the general society also, a ordinary man is also obeying. Why are they obeying? To the essay. Because their obedience is not to this person who is holding the SI position. Obedience is not to the person who holds the authority, but to the impersonal order, which is rational. He works based on rules and regulations. Say, for example, if this constable does something wrong, he has to act upon the rules and regulations. If someone is not wearing the seat belts or drunk and drive, he cannot act on his own. He has to act according to the rules and regulations. Legal, rational authority. Here, what is legal? Why is it legal? It is legal because authority is exercised by means of system of rules and procedures. Please concentrate here. Very important. And it is rational because these means are expressly designed to achieve certain specific ends. Very important. Bureaucracy is based on legal and rational authority. Legal and rational authority. How can you say that this is rational? Authority is rational because the means are expressly designed to achieve certain specific things. Let me explain these things with example. And also, authority is exercised by means of system of rules and procedures, not arbitrarily. So it is legal. Then your SI, who is exercising authority, will be by means of system of rules and procedures. SI will be following certain rules and procedures, so it is legal. Don't you feel that he is following some rules and procedures? So it is legal. Not only that, the rules and procedures, which are the means, these are expressly designed to achieve specific ends based on logic, based on knowledge. So they are rational also. Say, for example, a person who is not wearing the seat belt, for him, the fine is 500. The same person who is wearing the seat belt, but he is drunk and driving, what is the fine? 20,000. This is rational because they are designed to achieve certain ends. These are not randomly put. So that is legal rational authority. So very, very important characteristic of bureaucracy is it is legal and rational authority. Please take this PDF and read it minimum 3 times per day. If you don't read these things, what I have told, at least before tomorrow's class, minimum 3 to 4, I feel and I strongly believe that you cannot connect anything. Because these are such important things, very, very important. You have to connect these things. Then coming to the bureaucratic characteristics. Bureaucrats are subject to authority only in the official capacity. What are the first important character here? The subject, they are subjected, bureaucrats are subjected to authority only in the official capacity. See here, please understand these things as a very, very important concept required for management of any big organization. Then only you can understand this concept. These are the characteristics which have to be present in any big organization. If these characteristics are not present, it is not possible to manage this organization. Take for any organization, it is private or public. If these characteristics are not present, it is very, very difficult to manage. Let me explain these things by taking one of the most familiar thing, that is your police organization. Bureaucratic characteristics should be followed by all individuals to manage any big organization. till recently, the only big organizations were the organizations which were run by the state, the government. Till recently, the only big organizations were your public organizations, your government organization. That is the reason the concept of bureaucracy became similar to all the big organizations like civil services, military services. Because previously, it is unthinkable. See, your Amazon, Google, all these big organizations are of recent origin. Some 100 years back, some 200 years back, when the concept developed, the only big organization of were public service organization or government organization. So people got they got used to using bureaucracy for government organization. But bureaucracy is present in all the organization. Any big organization cannot be managed without this bureaucratic character. In this, I'll be taking police and I'll be explaining. Bureaucrats are subjected to authority only in the official capacity. They are organized in a hierarchical order. You take any organization, Amazon or your police, the authority what they have is only in the official capacity, not in personal. And it is organized on hierarchy. As I shown you, what is hierarchy? Hierarchy means complete. Hierarchy means complete control and supervision of the subordinate is with the superior. What is hierarchy? Hierarchy means when there is complete control and supervision of the subordinate by the superior. Say, for example, this is true in case of your police organization, in case of military organization, because they have got complete control and supervision with respect to subordinates. We cannot say the same when it comes to other organizations. Say, for example, in a school, in a hospital, there may not be present. So hierarchy very important. In a crisp way, I am telling, when there is complete control and supervision of the subordinate by the superior, there is hierarchy. So in all bigger organization, big organization, hierarchy must be there. That each officer had defined function. In this organization, each office had defined competence. Your constable has a different competence. Your SI has a different competence. Your SP has a different competence. Each office has different competences. Bureaucrats are selected on merit basis or through open merit examination. See this one. So in bureaucracy, one of the important thing, what is that? Merit. You apply that to all big organizations. Can you think of any big organization where there is no merit system? Can you think of Google surviving? Very good. If there is no merit system at all, there is no hierarchy at all. Can you think? No, it is unthinkable. Yes, students, bureaucrats are appointed on professional qualifications. They are paid fixed salary, allowances, and perks. Their office is their sole occupation. Bureaucracy is characterized by a career system in which they are prompted on the basis of seniority and merit. Official is separated from the means of participation. Of this. Bureaucracy is characterized by a career system. This is very, very important. In your interview, what they are seeing? They are seeing whether this individual is suitable for a career in civil service, when, and also is this officer will be able to make civil service as a sole occupation? What is meant by sole occupation? Have you ever come across an individual? Say, for example, I am a constable. I work, like my work starts hypothetically 8 a.m. to say, for example, 8 hours from this. Okay, 4 to 5 p.m. I am a constable. My working hours are 8 to 5. Afterwards, I am a taxi driver. Have you heard these kind of things? Huh? I am working in IRS, Indian Revenue System. My work is 10 to 5. Afterwards, I will act as a accountant for a company. Have you ever seen these kind of things? This is the sole occupation. See, I am a businessman. Say, for example, I have one company. I can have another company. I'm a politician. I can be owner of some company. I can do some other thing. I can do anything. But when you are a bureaucrat, when you are working in bureaucracy, your office is the sole occupation. And also it is characterized by a career system. You have a career day where you are getting promoted based on seniority and merit. The official is separated from the means of administration. Administration is different. The personal things are different. The means of administration which are given to you should not be used by the official. Don't you feel all these things should be present in a big organization like Amazon or Google? These are the characteristics of bureaucracy. These are subjected to strict discipline. These are self-explanatory things. Please go and once again read it as many times as possible. Very, very important. Now let me sum up. This summing up things is given by the great Mohit Bhattacharya. What are the properties? If you have not understood the things what I have told, don't bother. This is another way of explaining in the is it clear? So in bureaucracy, hi students, am I audible and visible to you? Okay.
Yes, sir.
So in bureaucracy, you have got division of work, you have got hierarchy, you have got system of rules, you have got role specificity. There is system of rules and also role specific. Roles which you play are very, very specific. These are the structural properties. There is no need for you to add the same sequence or anything like that. If you write among these things 2 to 4, it will be more than sufficient. In bureaucracy, we have got structural things. They are division of work, hierarchy, system of rules, and role specificity. On the other hand, you have got behavioral characteristics. What are they? They are rationality, impersonality, rule orientation, neutrality. Neutrality, rule orientation, impersonality, rationality. These are the things present. So if you write these things, it's enough. No need for you to go in depth. If you still have any doubt, I'll share it from this. So here, this becomes very, very important here. Bureaucratic values that are in consonance with those of democracy. Bureaucratic values that are in consonance. The opposite of in consonance is which are in antagonistic relationship. Bureaucratic values which help in the development of democracy, where there is a symbiotic relation with democracy and bureaucracy. So, bureaucratic values which are in consonance with those of democracy are, students, one, recruitment through open merit-based system. See here, see, please understand here, I'm explaining these things, bureaucratic values that are in consonance, in agreement with those of democracy. Very important. We have got bureaucracy, role of civil service, role of civil service in democracy you have. See, I'm saying those things, those characteristics of bureaucracy which are leading to, which are helping democracy, which are not in opposition to democracy, which are in consonance with democracy. What are these? Recruitment through open merit-based system. So how you say that this characteristic is in accordance with democracy? See, when you are recruiting through open merit-based examination, you are giving opportunity for all. So it is a democratic value, democratic ethos. During recruitment, you are not favoring any individual. You are treating equally, open competition, transparently you are coming. The criteria for recruitment is merit. So all are eligible for that. If you have the merit, you go for that. No discrimination based on race, religion, caste, sex, or anything. Merit is the basis for recruitment. So this is in alignment, in consonance with the democracy. Recruitment based on professional qualification. You are recruiting an individual based on the professional qualification, not based on your individual wills. Or not because they are your family members, no nepotism. So definitely it is a value which is in consonance with democracy. The administrator, he is separated from the means of administration. The administrator is separated from the means of the administration. By making this, you are not giving any undue advantage to the individual who is an administrator. All the means of administration should be exercised within the framework, according to rules and regulations, and according to them, and also when you are performing those government functions. Not always. You may be IPS officer when you are on duty. For others, you are just an ordinary person. See, there is one more very, very important: political neutrality. This is a very, very important factor which is in consonance with democracy. Because being in an administrative place, you are maintaining political neutrality. By this, democratic values can flourish. bureaucrat's office is the sole occupation. Because of that, he is not involved in any other power politics. It is a career system. Because of this, since bureaucrat's office is the sole occupation, he won't be allowed into other places like politics or any other economical forms. Since bureaucrat's sole office is your civil service, or any, for that matter, if he is there in civil service. For others, since it is their sole occupation, they won't be involved in some vested things with respect to economy or the political sphere. Bureaucrats are subjected to strict discipline and have to run the administration according to rules and regulations. These are some of the things which are in consonance with the democracy. On the other hand, there are some things which are antagonistic to democracy. Bureaucratic values that are antagonistic to democratic values and ethics. What are these? If you take a look, number one, it will be rigid hierarchy. What is hierarchy? Complete control. Complete control and supervision of the subordinate by the superior. Because of that, an individual is losing the democratic character, democratic values. Means you are dehumanizing this person. There is dehumanization of the person. Rule oriented. When it is rule oriented, it is no more democratic. You are acting based on the rules. There is value neutrality. See, values, the opposite is with respect to facts. Facts are reality. Say, sun rises in the east. This is a fact. On the other hand, values, these are related to individual. These are based on the individuals. Right? So, rigid hierarchy, rule orientation, values being neutral, these are the things which are antagonistic to your democracy. On the other hand, merit system and all related things are in consonance with the democratic ethos and values. Yes, students, bureaucracy means, please understand like this, all the characteristics what we have studied. If these are present in an organization, then it will be one of the most superior. It will be one of the most superior. You think of coming up with an organization which is not based on career system, which is not based on merit system, which is not based on legal rational authority. Can you sustain an organization for long? Can you think of any organization, any big organization without hierarchy? From the purely technical point of view, bureaucracy is capable of attaining the highest degree of efficiency. Thus, it is the most rational means of carrying out impersonal control over human beings. Bureaucracy is the most rational known means. Bureaucracy is a means of carrying out impersonal control, not personal control over human beings. This impersonal control is based on rules and regulations, laws and regulations. So it is the one which is capable of attaining highest efficiency, highest degree of efficiency. It is one of the most rational, based on reason and knowledge, capable known means of carrying out impersonal control over human beings. It is superior to any other form of organization in precision, stability, discipline, and reliability. It thus makes possible a high degree of calculability, of the results for the heads of the organization. Because of all these things, the head of the organization of the police department can guess what will be the thing. If these bureaucratic characteristics are not present, how can a king know what a soldier can do? So this is a very superior to any form of organization in precision, with respect to stability, with respect to discipline and reliability. If you don't have bureaucratic characteristics, there won't be precision. There won't be stability in the organization. There won't be discipline in the organization, and they are not reliable. And there won't be possible for the person who is there in the higher strata to hold the lower one accountable. It is also superior in intensive efficiency as well as in scope of its operations. It is capable of application to all kinds of administrative tasks. It is completely indispensable for the needs of the mass administration in modern times. The people once ruled by monocratic bureaucracy can never think of any other alternative form of organization. To sum up, Weber stated that bureaucracy is the most efficient, most rational, superior to any form, indispensable and permanent. So these are some of the advantages according to Weber. It is the most superior in intensive efficiency, in efficiency also, and also scope. It can be applied to wide organizations, government, non-government, NGOs. It is completely indispensable. You cannot think of any kind of organization to meet the needs of the mass administration in modern times. It is completely indispensable for the needs of the mass administration in modern times. The people, once you are ruled by bureaucracy, you never can think of any other alternative forms. So it is said to be one of the most important and also indispensable. Right? So there are many other things with respect to the criticisms, all these things. I'll be taking up all these things tomorrow. Dear students, if you have got any doubt with respect to these things, please let me know.